And Harris. Oh, close.
Another good length, good line. That's what Harris brings. He always attacks the stumps. He's not one of those bowlers that bowl just corridor and try and build up pressure. He actually attacks the stumps. He's quicker than you think. Seeing him getting up in high 80 mile an hour, nearly 90 mile an hour. Very fast. He's strong. In the pick of the bowlers.
I think the gentleman with the pot of paint and the brush is about ready. Certainly couldn't want a better opportunity to get 5 wickets and to get up on that honors board. Early in the morning, get the fourth wicket early, still fresh. Jimmy Anderson, broad swan to bat. You must be backing yourself to get 5 wickets. Score stays 299 for 8. Well, you can see there what Shane Warne was talking about. Excellent line. Not too many balls that are wide of the off stump for batsmen to leave it all alone. A bit more varied as far as bowling to left-handers are concerned, because he's bowling right over the wicket, so he's pushing the ball across the body of the left-hander more than anything else. Tall man, Stuart Broad, so he can get on top of those.
I get a sense that the Australian bowlers are going to go after Stuart Broad here. Michael Clark's got a little leg gully for a man, for Stuart Broad, wants to get up on his toes. It looks like he wants to play the short ball and not duck it. He's got also two men back on the hook for any sort of top edge. See, left of screen there, the two men back on the boundary. Man around the corner for a catch. Mid-on's close. Expect a few short stuff. Bit of chin music.
And when you have the chin music going, Warney, batsmen will play shots like that.
Yep, agreed. You can see Stuart Broad, I think it was the last time he was playing back in the crease. So already Australia have got him playing deep in the crease and back, expecting the short pitch deliveries. And it's important the follow-up deliveries a good length and make the batsmen play. Don't give them a freebie too wide or a half volley. They can get off and release that pressure. Important the batsman knows it's coming. Still, they get tentative and just fiddle outside that off stump.
Runs. That was well timed. Fast outfield. I think it will get there, you know. It just about gets there. Brings up 300.
Every run crucial for England. Bringing up that 300 now. His outfield's quick, Mikey. That was nothing more. It was a length ball in at the body. He just sort of dabbed at it and pushed at it. Beat mid on and never looked like it wasn't going to get the boundary. Just raced away for 4.
Michael Clark just making a change in the field here, putting another man in the slip cordon. He had 3 slips before the gully comes in. There's also a man in a deep second gully, almost a backward point. No ball is the umpire's call. Ray Rasmus watching that front foot.
You see fast bowlers who didn't have a very good day and come back the next day searching for that rhythm. Bowling's all about rhythm. That's a fair way over for a fast bowler. You see him start to bowl no balls. You know he's still struggling and trying a bit too hard. Bowlers need to find a way to somehow relax and get their groove going and really think about rhythm. There's a few different ways you can do that. A lot of bowlers think about the exact spot they want to bowl on the pitch and they get so obsessed with bowling that and not bowling any rubbish that they can concentrate too hard and not relax. Sometimes it's worth thinking about what shot you want the batsman to play and that can help you feel your rhythm. And as we saw yesterday, the ultimate sin, Peter Siddle knocked over Johnny Bairstow. The score, I think, England were on 175. 175 for five and went on. Got some score, made a big partnership, so got to get that foot behind the line. No excuses.
Noah Wide. Really not having things go too well for him at all, Pattinson. I think Michael Clarke may be thinking, time to make a change. Perhaps the second innings will be his.
Steve Smith, maybe. The new ball. I think it's going to be Siddle, wouldn't it, Mikey? I'm just trying to, you know, I'm thinking about the leg spinner, you know, 3 for yesterday, bowled pretty well. Give him a couple more.
Well, if he wasn't convinced that he needed a change, that might be the convincing stroke. We owe 9 for 8.
Yeah, day one, we're going to show you through the next 5 days, or next few days, about how the pitch wear and tear, the wear and tear on the pitch. And have a look at this for day one. There's a fair bit of rough there that Graham Swan will be keeping an eye on and starting to like, too. It's a dry pitch, but that's a lot of footmarks there for a day one pitch. It means that the pitch is quite dry underneath. And I think the wicket, by looking at the wicket now, it's going to turn as the day goes on, as we see. We saw Steve Smith spin a couple yesterday. Graham Swan, we know what quality he is. But he could cause a few hassles.
Left-handers, as usual, having problems with the off-spinner coming round the wicket at them, pitching in those rough areas. Here's Harris again.
Just looking at that last over with Broad smacking one through the covers for four, and Michael Clarke had the double teapot going with the hands on the hips. Just think he was the field he set. I think he expected Pattinson to come out and bowl some good short stuff at him. He had a leg gully, had two back on the hook, and it didn't quite happen.
Edged and gone through the slip, caught on for four. Should have been Harris's fifth wicket. It's another 4 runs for England.
Well, Michael Clarke had the double teapot on. I'm not sure it's impossible to have a quadruple or triple teapot. I think that went right. It was right in the middle of Haddon and Watson. And Haddon sort of let it go. And Watson was just late to move. Normally that's a keeper's catch. And it can really put first slip off. And you think the keeper's going to go and he doesn't go. The reaction from first slip is always late. And everything happens so fast. It's a big one gone, that.
I think most times, Warney, the unwritten rule is anything to first slips right. If you are standing to a left-handed batsman, of course, it's the wicket keepers. Edged again, this time gone. 5 for Harris on the honours board.
Well done, Ryan Harris. He deserved that. He's bowled beautifully so far in this test match. He deserved the 5 wickets. We're just going to check the front foot here. Ryan Harris is generally pretty good. Batsman just been asked to wait. Ryan Harris is generally very good. Yep, he's miles behind. Disappointing the umpire want to check that. I'm sure he still keeps an eye on that front line. A long way behind. But well done, Ryan Harris. Jimmy Anderson has gone. He did a pretty good job last night as night watchman to protect the tail. He's gone for 12. England at 313 for 9.
Sky Sports coverage of the Ashes is sponsored by The Times and The Sunday Times. Sky Sports coverage of the Ashes is sponsored by The Times and The Sunday Times.
Graham Swan coming in at number 11 now for England, with Jimmy Anderson being promoted yesterday. That's another reason why I wouldn't want a night watchman if I was slated to bat at 9 or 10. I don't want to be pushed one more position down. But that's the fifth wicket. Jimmy Anderson caught by Haddon, and fantastic bowling performance this by Ryan Harris. His 13th test match, certainly not an unlucky number for Ryan Harris. Oh, that was almost six. What a delivery.
Well, that's a peach. That's an absolute jaffa. That's full and it's gone like a leg break. Really went that. It's gone a long way there, and it went quite quickly. What you just look where Brad Haddon's taking that. You mentioned it earlier, Mikey, about the pace of the wickets. Really, it's got a lot quicker this wicket. Ryan Harris has cranked it up too. It's nearly 90 mile an hour, that delivery. It's pumped. He's got his five wicket. He wants six.
Off the mark, Graham Swan. Here's this delivery again that got him his fifth wicket. Reasonably well pitched up. Ooh, not as well gloved as you would have liked, but he held it nonetheless. And have a look at where Ryan Harris's front foot is. Now that was asked to be referred, looked at by the third umpire. And that's the reason, Warnie, why when I hear people saying that the referral should be left to the umpires and not the players. If an umpire is going to refer that, he'll refer a lot of things. Oh, yeah. Oh, going past the outside edge again. 314 for 9.
Yeah, well done, Ryan Harris. I agree with you, Mikey. That is an umpire. Got to be still looking at the line. It's so far behind. If he's going to refer that to say, let's just check it. He was miles behind. Just causes slow things he don't need to. The umpire's there to job, make the call. Nine down now. They need Broad and Swan to get a little bit of partnership. Try and get towards that 350 mark.
Warm round of applause for Ryan Harris. Certainly deserved that. 5 for 52 in 23 overs. Well, as we thought, Pattinson is out of the attack. Shane Watson is back.
The deja vu from the same as yesterday. A couple of overs from Pattinson getting whacked around, not quite getting it right. Straight to Shane Watson. Bowls pretty well to right hand. You know what you're going to get from Shane Watson. Doesn't try and bowl too fast anymore. He just bowls pretty line, pretty much full around that off stump. Nips around a little bit of like that. Gets the odd bit of swing. He used to be able to bowl quite fast, Shane Watson, and obviously his body. Oh no. What he suffered, so now he's just one of those guys who bats and bowls a few overs. Important time now that Australia don't let this tail wagon get up towards 350. Get it done, knock over the last wicket, then get back out there and have a bat. This wicket's pretty good to bat on. get in there with the momentum, Australia. Just think that Michael Clark, with someone like a Graham Swan, we know he doesn't play the short ball very well at all. With someone like a Peter Siddle, who bowled well yesterday, might have been worth working him over with a bit extra pace, the Swan. With someone like a Shane Watson, he's more handy to a top order player like Alistair Cook, because he'd be a bit more wary of someone like Watson. Or a number 11 like Swan, you want to give him a lot of short stuff, so you need a bit extra pace. Peter Siddle.
Might be a bit biased, Warney, but I certainly agree with you.
To me, you don't want a number 11 like that, just looking comfortable on the front foot like he's having a net and a throwdown. You want to make him feel uncomfortable. You want a couple whizzing around his ears. Then he suddenly goes back, starts to think he's going to get short ones at him. We know Swan doesn't play the short one very well. Doesn't like it at all.
Runs. Very valuable runs, these, for England.
Yeah, we know Swan, if he's allowed to throw the bat at that, he has got a lot of talent with the bat and can hit the ball very well, especially against medium pace bowling. Any width like that, he's going to throw the sink out, he's going to throw everything. He's a good striker of the cherry. More pace. Shane Watson to roll the clock back here and bowl a nice quick bumper. Might snap in half though, Mikey. Nice to see some hats in the crowd, sunglasses, protection from the sun. Probably have all gone out and bought them, I think. There hasn't been too much sun for the last few years, Mikey.
.318 for nine. England will be hoping that this last wicket pair can get a few runs on the board. We've got a change in the commentary box. Andrew Strauss is with Mike Atherton.
Thank you, Mikey. Uh-huh. Where is that? Is that those the cheap seats? Where is he? Grandstand, mound stand. No, Edrich stand. Up high in the Edrich stand. Prime Minister enjoying the day. Oh! Some rumours you were going to take up a Tory seat, weren't there, Andrew? Some time ago.
Some very false rumours, yeah. Not.
You're of that persuasion, though, aren't you?
I thought the bigger challenge would be trying to make my way in the game of commentary, to be honest with you. But it's nice to see the Prime Minister here, isn't it? I mean, big cricket fan, and no better place to watch cricket than here today at Lord's.
You say he's a big cricket fan. I think I'm right in saying that when
Paul Collingwood was introduced to him once. He called him Colin, didn't he? Colin Wood. Nice to see you, Colin. And you, Dave.
That is the rumour, yes.
Well, it's nice to see him enjoying the day, relaxing, enjoying the cricket. From Australian Prime Minister John Howard as well, who is a self-confessed cricket tragic. What about Stuart Broad's batting? He went through that phase where his batting just declined a bit, didn't he? Came into the team very promising. One or two innings where people said, this is a all-rounder in the making, genuine all-rounder in the making. Then his batting just seemed to drift away a bit.
Yeah, well, we all know Stuart Broad's a guy that knows his mind pretty well. And I think he got caught up with this idea that he was a big shot player, that he should just go out and play loads of shots all the time. I always felt that he had the ability to be a bit better than that, a little bit more judicious in which balls he played and which what balls he left. And I think we saw that in the last couple of innings he's played, that he's got himself in. He's obviously a very good shot player. Here we go, look at him at Lords, 46 and a half. He had that amazing 169 in that controversial test match against Pakistan. He's got the capability to score 50s and 100s for England, and that's a great asset. Yeah.
It's good from Swan. There is a man out at deep square leg. Usman Khawaja.
We saw it, Trent Bridge, Australia putting on 160-odd for the last wicket. Well, England got a good chance with these two as well. Swan and Broad, a very promising last wicket pair for England here. Could easy take the game away from Australia, and they'll play like this. They'll play their shots. Not going to be scared of hitting the ball by any means. Should be a really fascinating contest, this, between Harris and Swan. Coming round the wicket now, Ryan Harris.
Yeah, I remember Swan's first Ashes Test match, must have been at Cardiff, I guess, 2009. They really peppered him. Peter Siddle got really stuck into Graham Swan. And he might be in for a bit more here now as Harris changes his angle around the wicket. The sight screen is adjusted. There's a leg gully, two men out on the hook. Fairly clear signal sent as to what's to come. .321 for 9.
One thing's for sure, Graham Swan won't block it. You know, if he bowls short of him, he's going to take it on. It's going to be you or me looking at the scorecard. Good start from Australia this morning. Tim Bresnan out first ball. Harris with the 5 wickets. He's bowled exceptionally well, but that last wicket stand for England could be crucial. There we go. Ryan Harris, 5 for 55 at Lords. A fantastic performance from him. And the 3 wickets for Steve Smith last night.
Not for 95, James Pattinson off 20 overs, not his easiest day yesterday. So Peter Siddle replaces him. There's some glove there. Landed short of Brad Haddin in any case. It's a difficult area sometimes for left hand. It's a bit of a blind spot when the ball is in that rib area.
Pretty obvious Australia going to go quite short of both Broad and Swan. I think they feel they're both vulnerable there. The problem for a captain with that strategy is there's only one way of taking the wicket, which is if they hit it out to those men in the deep or they glove one to the slip fielders, the stumps are largely out of play. So if you're going to do it, you need to commit fully to it. Maybe they need another man out there and you commit fully to it for 3 or 4 overs. Otherwise, you might find that the scoreboard goes rattling along very quickly here for England.
Yeah, and I suppose from a batsman's perspective, they can predict what's coming. I mean, that wasn't actually that short. It wasn't a bouncer length from Siddle, but because Broad has got it in his mind that he's going to get a short ball, he's rather waiting for it. Just clubs this away over mid-on. Just think with Stuart Broad, you want to send him the signal that the short ball is coming, but in fact, you're better off attacking him with a fuller length delivery.
Yeah, I suppose there's that thing of getting it in his head. So he waits back. He's thinking it's going to be short. And if you go fuller, then he's not going to be in control of his drive. He still play the drive, Stuart Broad. He's not going to leave it, but he won't be in as good control of the shot. So that is an opportunity for a fielding side. I just think this wicket is still pretty slow. We've seen people taking on the pull shot quite comfortably. It's quite a high-risk strategy to go too short too often at these two.
That shows what a good pitch it is. Lovely shot from Stuart Broad. Not a bad delivery from Siddle, a little on the fuller side. But it is a pristine pitch still, and you can hit through the line of the ball with great freedom.
There we go. Stuart Broad's weight probably was a little bit back there, but beautiful hands through the ball, and that's what he's capable of. He's a very good timer of the ball, Stuart Broad, and that was a good example.
Shorter this time to finish the over. 329 for 9. Long room not quite as packed as at the start of play, when the members like to get a glimpse of the players walking through there, but it's a nice cool place to be on a very hot day. Beautiful. Beautiful from Swan. A bit of a half volley from Ryan Harris, but it was put away with great efficiency.
Graham Swan's turn to get in the act. Another very sweet timer of the ball, and it's a perfect delivery for him. Very good player of the cover drive, which is why people mainly bowl short at him, but he's played that one exceptionally well.
Yeah, might not be quite so gentle, this from Harris. Wants to hit the pitch a bit harder. That first one was a very kind of floaty half volley, and second ball just hit the pitch a bit more.
As you can see there, they've been a little bit all over the shop with these last two. Trying to surprise the batsman, I suppose.
Well, man out, but not in front of square. These are good runs for England. The partnership is worth 24 now between Swan and Broad.
I suppose this is a challenge for Michael Clarke here. To what extent does he just stick with bowling line and length? Here we go, short, sits up. And Swan's got a lot of time to play that shot. Do you just stick with what worked against the top order, or do you try and funk it up against these two? You know they're going to play shots anyway. So, yeah, it can end up chasing your tail a little bit, trying too many things rather than just keeping it simple.
Well, in the last, what, 8 balls, we've seen a few half volleys, we've seen a few half trackers. Maybe back to hitting a length. Another full one, and the boundary's flowing. It's good tactics from England, just not sitting there allowing Australia to bowl. Swan 19, Broad 22, and the scoreboard rattling along.
Here we go again, slightly full from Harris, and Swan in great position to play that shot. Really important runs these for England. 341 for 9. Score's getting up there to that kind of respectability stage where England will fancy their chances. Got some momentum here, these two, and they need to kind of push on, I suppose.
Shows what a good pitch it is still, though. You're right, 350 and you're in the game. In the first innings, you might think 400 a par score. It's the kind of score and the kind of pitch that you might be a bit worried about if you've got, say, that long, brilliant South African batting lineup ahead of you. But Australia are not at that stage yet with their batting. It looks a bit more fragile than, say, South Africans from last year. So you'd feel with 350 you're well in the game. Still, as we've seen, a good pitch. .342 for 9.
Quick look at the last over from Ryan Harris. Beautiful shot from Graham Swan through extra cover. First up, two full. Ryan Harris goes short, come back. Swan's got an answer for that as well. Great shot through mid-wicket. Was up with a full one again. Three-card trick, and Swan's made good use of that. 12 runs for Graham Swan in that over.
That's the point, really, illustrated, that you can get sucked into going a bit short and full against tail-enders, whereas Ryan Harris was bowling to you or Alistair Cook or whoever, he'd be looking to hit a length rather than going short and full.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, if you look at both Swan and Broad, you'd probably say, how do we look to get them out? Swan, maybe you'd say you've got a chance LBW early, but they nick off a lot of the time. They'll nick off to the slips, caught behind, and you generally nick off to good length balls. Those are the balls that are the most dangerous to play those big expansive shots to.
Yeah, when you're looking to force something that's not there to force at the moment, Australia just gifting Swan and Broad too many opportunities to score. So it's very important Michael Clarke gets a grip on this quickly. What a shot that is. And that's not a bad delivery from Siddle. Perfectly good delivery, but slammed down the ground by Broad. Yep, I think he likes it.
Yeah, you're right. Nothing wrong with this delivery whatsoever, but Stuart Broad got a bit of momentum. I mean, that is an unbelievable cricket shot, just back of a length, and he's hit it through mid-off for 4 runs. Nothing the bowler could do about that, but I wouldn't mind that as a bowler. If he's playing those shots, I'm pretty happy, I reckon.
Yeah, high hands, high back lift, getting on top of the bounce. Michael Clarke just took some time out then to have a word with Siddle, almost just to slow things down, I think. Slightly getting away from Australia. Had a good day yesterday, a good end to the day. They had a good start to the day this morning. Very important, they just don't allow things to get away from them. Run rate rattling along, 6.21. That's on the back of this partnership, 35 between Broad and Swan.
Although it's always a bit of a nightmare for a captain in these circumstances where the last pair are putting on runs, if I put my opening batting hat on, I always quite like seeing the last pair scoring some runs, because it made me think, well, if they can get runs on this wicket, then there's nothing to really fear. Paul's still pretty new here, and they can hit through the line, then as an opening batsman you think maybe it's not going to be that challenging when Australia finally get the ball in their hands, or when England get the ball in their hands, sorry.
Swan over the top this time. Sure, it's going to go, actually. Chris Rogers giving chase. But it's three more, and the 350 is up now. 351 for nine. Come on, Dave, that's worth a clap.
Both in full flow, these two. We often talked about going through the gears as batsmen when these two were in. Kind of, lads, just go through the gears. Well, tending to get to fifth gear very quickly, and that's where they're at the moment.
Now, high, man out. Oh, he's just not picked it up. It's gone for six in any case. The boundary is in, but for a long time there, that man out at square leg, just unsure of where the ball was. I think it's Khawaja. 357 for nine.
Unbelievably high. Stuart Broad gave it a full kitchen sink. The bat went straight up in the air. Khawaja didn't pick it up, came in too far, and, well, if he'd stayed right on the edge, he might have just taken that one.
Yeah, you're right. He was in no man's land. Had he been on the fence and stayed on the fence, he would have caught this. But A, he started 15, 20 yards in. Then he had no clue, really, where the ball was. Had to backtrack. It only just crept over the rope. So, again, he's in that position, a good 10 or 15 yards in from the rope. They're not big boundaries here at Lord's.
Michael Clarke looking a bit concerned here. Again, it's a hard time for a captain because the ball's going in funny areas. They could be caught out on the hook. You still need your slip fielders in for the big drive that they nick. But if you have too many slip fielders in, there are too many run scoring opportunities. Quite a hard time for Michael Clarke right now.
Trying to recall the partnership that these two put on at Headingley in 2009. 108 in 12 and a half overs. It was a losing cause for England. Memory of the game. Did it finish in 2 days or two and a bit days? Within 3 days. But it was a blistering partnership on that occasion. And at the moment, it's 44 from 35. It's a good ball. If they are going to bowl short, they've got to be tight in at the body to both these players.
So Cook and Kevin Beaton be enjoying this. Some really useful momentum here for England.
Better line, top edge again. Once again, the fielder a long way in. I just feel they should be further back, these guys, out in the deep. These are not long boundaries here at Lord's.
Right there. Here we go. I mean, watch how hard Graham Swann's hitting that. He's not trying to just lean on that ball. He's giving it the full kitchen sink. And Pattinson there's a long way in, probably 20 yards in from the boundary. Really frustrating, just evading the fielders.
Oh, yeah.
Well, it's good stuff. Good stuff between Broad and Swan. Nice 10th wicket partnership for England against Australia here at Lord's. It's 47 by Anderson and Onions. Wow.
Not sure that one would have been scored quite so quickly.
No, that was Anderson in his better days as a batsman, I reckon. Short and full, that's where Australia are at the moment, but it's not working for them. 361 for 9. Concern from Australia's coach Darren Lehman in the visitors dressing room there. Michael Clark switching things around. They've got to get this last wicket partnership done. It's 48 off just 39 balls. England rattling along, 361 for 9. Graham Swan has just taken a bit of a blow actually on his right arm, so he's taking a moment out. If you recall, he took a nasty blow at Chelmsford which concerned the England medical staff. He's just taken another. Ian Botham, Nasser Hussain.
Thanks, Michael. Yeah, it was Tamal Mills that hit him. The Essex left armer hit him just there. Missed the day of that warm-up game. Went for an X-ray, which was absolutely fine. He's been hit there again. More importantly, these two have put on 48 in 39 deliveries. The old night watchman ploy worked, Beefy.
Yeah. More luck than judgment.
Is there an edge there? They're going up. Yes, and there's a nod. What will Stuart Broad do here? All eyes on Broad. Did I hit that? Go on, review it, Stuart. That's what he's telling him. That's out, son. No, Brody will still review it, just in case.
Maybe, perhaps it's a no ball, we couldn't see it. Let's have a look. There's nothing wrong with the delivery, that's coming down fine. Oh, I'm not sure. That's interesting. Does it flick the pad?
Did he edge it first? I mean, the Australians are virtually into the pavilion. Was there an edge and then pad? Hotspot will tell us, hopefully.
Now, this is the one that will tell us. Yep, there it is. Okay, there's the edge. Let's move on.
Yep, the Australians were literally into the pavilion. They weren't even waiting for the hot spot. It's only Stuart Broad and Graham Swan that's left in the middle. So a good partnership comes to an end. Harris ends up with 5 wickets. He's bowled quite brilliantly. By far the pick of the bowlers. Pattinson, not so good. He gets 1 wicket, the final wicket, but some useful runs at the end from Broad and Swan.
Big difference. 361. Here we go. You've not seen this yesterday. Cameras in the long room.
What a feeling for Ryan Harris. Walks through the long room. 5 wickets. All his injury concerns over the years. All that hard work he would have done in the gym, in and out of the gym, on the physio's bed. And he gets 5 wickets at Lord's. Brilliant effort from him. Got good players out as well at the top of the order. And came back well today with the wicket of Bresnan first ball. 109 for Bell, 67 for Bairstow. 58 from Trott and some useful tail end runs. 361 all out.
6 bowlers used. Pattinson expensive, 1 for 95 from 20 overs. Watson 1 for 45 from 13. Siddle no wickets for 76 from 22. Agar I think is carrying an injury, none for 44. Smith picked up those 3 wickets yesterday, but the pick of the bowlers by a distance, Ryan Harris, 5 for 72. Well bowled.
So England's innings is finished. We'll know in a day or so's time whether that was par or below par. It looks a good pitch and a quick outfield. We'll be back with you after this short break.
I had to make a lot of tough decisions to earn Ashes victories. Shying away wasn't an option.
So an hour into day two, and England have finally been bowled out for 361. It's been the series of 10th wicket partnerships at Trent Bridge. It was 163 and 65 for Australia. 48 today between Broad and Swan. And they played in a very positive manner. To be fair, they're no number 10 and number 11. Because of the night watchman, Swan was pushed down. They played beautifully. The only way tail-enders have to bat, really, be positive. It shows what a good pitch it is, though. Once that new ball is seen off, there is a bit of pace and a bit of bounce, but it's also good for batting for that reason. Some great shots from Broad. He enjoys this ground, batting at this ground. Swan's batting has improved in the last month or so. He's got some runs for England. That, for a second, looked like it was going to hole out to Khawaja in the deep. Went all the way. Swan had no idea where that went, but it's the best way to bat. You're going to swing, swing hard. Two Nottinghamshire boys went well. Three for Smith, one for Pattinson, one for Watson. And a fabulous spell of bowling yesterday and today. Ryan Harris, 26 overs, 5 for 72. What a selection. Beefy must be very impressed with this lad.
Well, Alan Border picked him from the start. He said he'd be his first choice. He's fit and ready to go. He's his first choice bowler. He said he bowls at the stumps. He takes wickets. If he stays fit, he's a handful. And he's proved that. Still can't work out how that got there, but leading edge, I think. But no, it was terrific bowling. That was the first ball this morning. As it went. Jimmy Anderson feeling for one. There it is. Quite right, hold that up. Name on the honours board.
Line bowler, look at the line of all those dismissals. One or two short balls just to rough up the opposition. But Andrew Strauss said this morning, he targets the stumps, he goes at those stumps. The left-handers, a lot of those deliveries would have been round the wicket. Bowls a good length, and he's a little bit quicker than you think. He just sort of ambles in. A little bit quicker than you think.
He's a bustler, isn't he? He comes bustling in. He's a strong man, naturally strong, and strong shoulder. It's good pace. Now, what's that man going to come up with today?
Yeah, the two informed players there for England so far in this series. Bell with the bat and Jimmy Anderson with the ball. Tim Bresnan has been out there for a long time having a bowl. He had a long bowl this morning. He's had a bowl between innings. What do you make of this pitch, Ian? Because generally day two here is pretty flat and good for batting.
It'll be a bit quicker than it was yesterday, I would think. But I think also we'll judge it when both sides have had a bowl on it. And I saw a couple of balls yesterday disturb the surface. And talking to the umpires this morning, they were saying that there's a little bit in there, particularly with the new ball. So if England can make some inroads, as Australia did yesterday morning, we'll wait and see. But I think Swan, again, he'll get more. If he does get turn here, he'll get bounce. So he can be quite a handful. England, they'll be very, very happy in that dressing room. 361, when you're 28 for three, you'll take every day of the week.
Here they come, the opposition opening batsman walked through. Chris Rogers has played a lot here. He's played for Middlesex. He enjoys this ground. He's got a fabulous record on this ground, Chris Rogers. He knows all about that walk. Shane Watson has been around a while as well. It won't be a new walk for either of them, just trying to get their minds right. Rogers played beautifully for Middlesex so far this summer. Can he do it for Australia? ...150-odd runs in first-class cricket this summer. Chris Rogers played well at Trent Bridge, 50 in the second innings. Shane Watson will be the key wicket, though, for Alistair Cook. Watson can hurt you. He bats for a couple of hours with this outfield. Watson will score quickly and heavily. Average going in the wrong direction. He's not had a great year in test match cricket. He's a better player than that, and he needs to show people that.
It's actually, I think, starting to play on his mind a little bit as well, Nass. He's getting starts all the time and getting out 30s, 40s, 50s. You're right, he's too good a player. Ryan, he's going to have to play well. This man's bowling as well, I think, as I've seen him bowl.
The average has popped below 30. He's just getting better and better with age. First time since his sixth test match that his average is below 30. He's a man at the top of his form. Fully fit. Back-to-back test matches. Jimmy Anderson would have done nothing really for 3 days. He's ready for this moment. Saw the Trent Bridge, a new nut in his hand, some Australian openers in his sights. 3 slips and a gully await Shane Watson. Has just done a little bit with that new ball, hasn't it?
I think as a bowler, you'd be thinking, make this count, make it count. Make some inroads. I think it will do a bit. And talking to the umpires, Nass, they said with a new ball, it did a bit. And he said, not a great deal, but enough to take the edge.
Yeah, there you go. Pitch that you need to be just that little bit fuller on, because when it does go, a batsman will miss it. That's what Harris was very good at, pitching the ball up, getting the batsman coming forward.
And there's that little variation in pace, which I think you'll see more of. But it's always exaggerated with the new ball, more apparent.
Watson not ready, just some movement. People going in and out the long room. A beauty now. There's an appeal there. There was a noise. Was it the back leg? Was it the back thigh? He goes to Pryor all the time. All three of them have to agree. Pryor doesn't agree with the bowler.
Well, Jimmy Anderson thought it was out, and Matt Pryor, for me, all along, was not convinced. It's a terrific delivery.
Let's have a look. I've got a feeling it's the back leg, Nas. I think it squares him up a little bit. Yeah, it's the thigh, back leg, I think.
Yeah, just flicked that pocket, didn't it? Just a glint on the bat where the sun gets it, so that's not the edge. Misses the edge. Good decision on the field. Good carry. Stephen Finn will be looking at this and thinking, I bowled on that flat one at Trent Bridge, and this has got a little bit more pace and bounce.
Yeah, England might be thinking of that themselves.
Chris Taylor, the ex-Gloucester player, who's now one of the ECB fielding coaches. He's out there showing the boys how to do it. He's a sub fielder because I think Graham Swann's off the field after that blow that he took on the arm. Jonathan Trott's popped into second slip. Good start from Anderson, this. The openers, the Australian openers, just have to keep saying to himself, see off this new ball. This afternoon will be great for batting. Get to lunch, don't lose a wicket. Good stats against England. Jimmy Anderson has said that he's one of the best opening batsmen he's had to bowl to. He's played him well. Got to show that now. Conversion rate is low, very low. Oh, the in-swinger. Very skillful from Anderson. It's a maiden, none for none.
That's what he does. He sets you up, doesn't he, Jimmy Anderson? Outswinger, 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 and the last ball of the over. Here she comes, the in-swinger. Not picked, but well played.
England have Anderson, who likes bowling at the pavilion end, and Broad, who likes bowling at the nursery end. Generally the other way around. Usually your swing bowler likes bowling at the nursery end and using the slope. Chris Rogers will know all about this slope. There is test stats. Only played two tests. Orthodox field. No short leg. England don't particularly like short leg fielders. Over the years, short leg has gone out of the game for England. Three slips and a gully. Very nearly 60. It needs 41 more runs to be the first person to get 1,000 runs in this year's first class season. Moeen Ali could get there before him. Quite got his line right. Just a slope, taking the ball down the leg side. You preferred the nursery end here, didn't you?
All the time. The advantage is with the slope, the ball, you always feel it's going to go down the slope, and if it holds its own, it's as good as going the other way. So for me, well, I've never had any choice anyway, because RGD Willis hogged the other end. But to be honest with you, this is always my choice. And I think if you're a swing bowler, this is the end to bowl.
Yeah, Anderson the anomaly to that. Anderson likes the pavilion end, and Finn, when he plays, likes the pavilion end as well. Bresnan will be quite comfortable at either end. Key to this test match and possibly the series, Australia's top order. They've shown that their tail enders can get big runs, good batsmen all the way down. Their top order can fire. They've got the bowling attack to bowl England out. This is the key moments of the game. See off the new ball, which will do a bit. It's supposed to. That's why opening the batting can be tough. It's supposed to do a bit, see it off, and then go big. Just one ball left. Another maiden. None for none.
Just have a look at this, Nas. I noticed this a couple of times yesterday. Just watch what happens with the pitch. There you go. There's a little bit more in this pitch than people think. It's dry, it's crusting, and I think you'll see uneven bounce, and it will do a little bit on here. And also, Graham Swan.
Very dry surface. The game against New Zealand earlier this year was very, very dry and spun. Couple of balls disturbing the surface. First innings run is going to be vital. Get him in the first innings, might be tougher second time round. Oh, it's another beauty. It's turned him round. Watson can't believe it.
It's always disconcerting, isn't it? You've been out in the field, you just watch 10 and 11 smack 50 runs off you, and then you go out there and suddenly it's talking to you, the ball.
Well played it late. That's the key with playing Anderson, playing him really late. Watch the swing. If you look at the first over, be a lot of movement away from the right-hander. And then just the one delivery that will swing back in. He'll set you up. Which delivery was it? Very last one. Five out swingers, one in swinger. Watch the ball out of the hand and play as late as possible. See it early, play late. But didn't carry. Played it reasonably well, soft hands, that's why it didn't carry.
Well, he's asking the question, isn't he, Shane Watson, at the moment, surviving, but he's at him, Jimmy Anderson, doesn't give you any respite.
Short ball, gets through, first runs, first boundary of the Australian innings. Swing and a miss. Went after the wide one. Australia 4 for none. Great view of a great ground. 4 for none, Australia. England made 361. Change up here. David Lloyd, David Gow.
Nice, Ness. The second substitute takes the field. This is Billy Root. Jimmy Anderson has left the field, one assumes, briefly. Taking a while for the first runs to come in this innings. Good tight, accurate bowling from Gordon Anderson. Both batsmen off the mark now. Watson with a boundary, Rogers with that single. Watson facing Broad for the first time in this innings.
Well, that's Chris Taylor, played at Gloucestershire, captain Gloucestershire. He's a fielding coach, a specialist coach. Big occasion. He must be the oldest sub ever. He's 36. Very lithe, a wonderful fielder. What a time. Two subs on. Quicker this pitch today, I think. Still an excellent batting surface and brilliant batting conditions. It's been very quiet so far. Khawaja comes in at 3. Michael Clarke drops down to 5. Who's the number 11 this time? Ryan Harris. How good's he?
Well, at least England had a bit of fun with the final wicket partnership today as well. Albeit, Broad and Swan would normally be higher up that order. That's actually 3, 4, 5 in a row, isn't it? Khawaja, Hughes and Clarke. Big appeal is close. It's all a question of how far that stride got down the pitch before the ball made contact. Whether or not contact was in line with the off stump. They're keen, England. They're keen to at least raise the question as to whether or not they need to review. But that conference again, that conference, we now know the rules of it. It's the keeper, the bowler and the captain all come together. they've decided not to go for a review. Mighty close, isn't it? Mighty close to the line of off stump. You always see the pad continue to move as the shot is completed. Mighty close. Umpire's call would have been. Umpire's call would have been. So, as said originally, very, very close. Not quite close enough for the umpire, and therefore not quite close enough for England to review it. All good. All good. Anderson, as suspected, off the field only for an over. He's back with the ball in his hands now. No doubt didn't enjoy that one.
Which is that broad appeal. I think he bowls this from wide of the crease, yet he jumps wider than normal. It didn't look right. He gets a good stride in. He could have been outside the line. It could have been quite high. Oh, hello. Bit of semaphore.
Just to clarify, that signal from the dressing room was after the replays. So, kind of confirmation that the decision was right not to go for the review.
I think both teams will be careful on reviews. Michael Clark conceding that he needed to be a bit more thoughtful. It didn't, that LBW didn't just look right. Worth an appeal, but not going to get it.
A couple of times Anderson this over already has been down the leg side uncharacteristically.
A good player to me, Rogers. Anderson got him twice at Trent Bridge, but he's organised, should be. Very experienced, 35 years of age. Has played here for Middlesex.
Nice work from Pryor there, very agile, but just something wrong with Jimmy Anderson this over.
Well, the great deliveries to a right-hander.
Getting straighter. Yeah, twice in the match at Trent Bridge, Anderson got Rogers. It was a change of angle, one that Rogers might have thought was thinking about going away. Didn't. It was the slightly slower ball. The plan, the one that got the acknowledgement to David Saker in the dressing room there to say, yeah, plan's worked. Just cut the fingers across the top of the ball. Rogers clipping it to mid-wicket that time. Well, it's a maiden, not a very good one. Five without loss. Well, Ian Bell, just to remind people, Ian Bell, the main player in England's 361, best of 67, Trott 58, Broad down the order again, 33. Last wicket flourishing actually today again for England. They were useful runs. 48 the partnership for the last wicket.
look at fall of wickets for England, they're in trouble at 28 for 3, 127 for 4, and a big partnership, and then another clatter of wicket. Steve Smith, part-time leg spinner, and then tail wagged. Decent score, 361.
Rod Marsh again. Saw him yesterday. Miss Broad off duty today. Match referee by trade.
From our position, we're always looking to tinker with the field, and Watson gets well forward. He gets that front foot right out there. There might be a case for a short leg. And look at that, inside edge, the ball balloons up. He gets a big stride in, and usually captains would think about, seriously think about having a short leg to deter that big stride. England have got Chris Taylor, substitute fielder, at a straight mid-wicket position.
No need to run for that. Beautifully struck. Warmly applauded.
Well, it's stand and deliver. Smacked it through straight mid off and just stood there.
Well, this is where he is so very strong, isn't he? Good stride forward. The ball's in the right place. This was right in his slot, let's face it. That's where he wants to be. Right length for him, right line for him, but take nothing away from the quality of the shot. Beautifully struck. Full again, this time didn't quite time it.
Likes that big booming drive, Shane Watson. Captain Cook comes all the way down to chat to Stuart Broad. He can maybe bring mid on and mid off very, very straight. Maybe restrict that big drive and try to make Watson to play a little bit square around his front pad. There'll be something here, it'll be somebody on the drive, fielder on the drive. Quite straight, yeah.
Well, it's good that Broad is hitting this full length. It does give the ball just the chance to do a little something here and there. Big inside edge.
Short leg's an option. He gets that huge stride in. He's a couple of times hit the inside edge onto the pad.
Nine without loss. No, I just had news of Graham Swan. He's off the field at the moment, having treatment on his forearm. That got hit again today while he was batting. Same area, no doubt, got hit in that warm-up match at Essex. So he's having treatment, but is expected to be back on the field in 15 minutes.
Well, Stuart Broad's just joined him. He's gone off.
Once again, one wouldn't expect that to be for long. This was the blow. It's one of those things for Graham Swan. He just gets into an awkward position sometimes. A mighty great big bruise coming up already.
Wonder what the treatment is there. Ice, compressions, massage. Like this lad, Chris Rogers, I think he knows where his off stump is. Helps that you've played a fair amount here. Play for Middlesex in county cricket. Reminds me so much of Justin Langer.
No run in the end, thought about it. Lots of shouts of wait.
England's run rate, 361, is at 3.6. They batted for 100 overs. Very careful from Australia against this new ball. You can just think, get rid of Anderson, get rid of the new ball.
That's pushed firmly down the ground through the gap at mid-off. Combination of fielding efforts. And the net result, 3 runs.
It's good running from Rogers. He scampered 3. Watson has got to just wait until the ball passes him. Rogers determined for 3. It's a good throw from Peterson there, right over the stumps.
Pretty good cricket all round. Nice shot. Good piece of fielding from Kevin Peterson. Better over that from Anderson. 12 in that loss. Yeah, just got his lines back there, didn't he? Previous over, he was too often leg stump and way down leg side. Just needed to tweak his radar and get back online. Little pink.
Change of bowling, Tim Bresnan.
Well, there'll be a bit of pressure on this man now, won't there? Because Stephen Finn was in the side, of course, the first test match. Had an up-and-down test match, I think it's the best way of putting it. Selectors decided to go for Bresnan here ahead of Finn. So the pressure on to perform. Just caught a glimpse in the background of Graham Swan. He's back on the field, back into his accustomed position at second slip. First ball is just driven through mid-off again. Not with any great power.
He's an accumulator from what we see. A very careful player, Rogers, and he gets on the drive there and pushes to mid-off. He's never going to get four, he'll get two. You'd expect that Bresnan will ball that full length. First delivery, 84 miles an hour, three slips and a gully.
Michael Liner on the left there. Sourav Ganguly as well. Sam Mendes at the back. You're a Bond fan, Bumble?
Not seen Sir Shirley Eaton. 14 without loss.
Well, session so far, seen three wickets go down for England, of course. Australia still behind, trailing by 347, but just trying to build on steady start of these first eight overs, 14 without loss. Just under 20 minutes to go now till lunch on day two, so a little change in the commentary box. Michael Holding is with Nasser Hussain.
Thanks, David. Steady start from Australia. Even you must be enjoying this weather, Michael Holding. This is summer, isn't it?
What do you mean by even me?
You're a little bit like me, you know. When it gets to about 20 degrees and everyone says this is hot, this is warm, you sort of moan and say this is not hot. This is not summer yet.
20 degrees is not hot, that's for sure.
Beautiful drive. That's his shot. Can get him into trouble with the LBW as he plants that leg, but if you get it wrong, he'll put you away.
Yeah, when it's as full as that, he won't get his leg in the way at all. It's when it's a fraction shorter, when he has already planted that right foot and then tries to play across it. But this is full. Not too difficult to put those away, especially when the ball isn't doing a lot off the seam. And you're right, now summer's arrived. Since July arrived, summer arrived with it. Fantastic weather. Proper cricketing weather.
Good lines, just the one delivery that's straight down the leg side.
It'll be interesting to see if England get reverse swing and how long it takes to get reverse swing in this test match. Pitch isn't as abrasive, the outfield isn't very abrasive either, neither the square.
It's more the length that Michael Holding been talking about, just that back of a length when he plants his front foot. Another good drive, even better this one. This wasn't a full half volley and he opened the face. There was an extra man in the covers. All he's done is pick the ball up from the pickets.
Excellent shot again from Shane Watson. Good placement as well. Full face of the bat. Just slightly angling the face to get it into the gap.
That's a cracking shot. That's not a half volley. Didn't deserve to go for four, but did. Now off the back foot. Two drives. Bairstow's quick. Might just be quick enough. Think about four. They stick with three. At the moment, it's 25 for none, but the third umpire will look at that.
I think Bairstow did well. That's a clear indication that he did an excellent job for his team. Saved a run. Don't think that's the one we're looking at. That's definitely four. But this one is the one that's the important one. Excellent work by Bairstow. Just into that little V. Had enough space.
Great work from Johnny Bairstow. Might get England a wicket, that. Shane Watson on strike now. Brilliant work. Watson finding some rhythm to his batting. Anderson's now bowled five overs. What was an ideal spell for you, Mikey? I mean, obviously not the 13 that he bowled on the bounce at Trent Bridge. Another good drive. I don't think Broad's chasing that one down.
Yeah, that's a length that you're looking to bowl when the ball is swinging and seaming around. If it's not doing a lot, that's a little bit too full. But that's Bresnan's length. That is where he's usually more effective. Just that conditions at the moment are not quite what would
enhance his bowling. I was a five over man, Nas. Five, possibly six. And hoping in the sixth that I wouldn't get a wicket to bowl a seventh.
Did it vary from day to day? Some days you just wanted to bowl more or less?
Yeah, definitely. It just depends on the circumstances. Sometimes with some batsmen you'd want one. One over is enough.
It is risk and reward with Shane Watson. You can see how strong he is on the cover drive. You do try and pitch the ball up to bring that LBW into play, but as Michael Holding says, the ball's got to be moving. If it doesn't move, then he'll nail you through the offside. So you try and drag it back, and he'll put you away square of the wicket as well. Good batting this from Shane Watson. Cook's got to think and rethink his plans.
Too much width. Fine if you want to drag it back because the ball isn't swinging, but you certainly cannot afford to give the batsman that amount of width outside the off stump. That's a freebie. No third man in place, so that's four every time.
Clip leg side, he'll come back for two. Trots back out in the deep. The one thing you can do with Shane Watson is set the field very straight and bowl stump to stump, and that might be what Cook's running up to Bresnan to, because Watson is a boundary hitter. Already in 29, he's hit six fours. He's not someone with soft hands who drops it into spaces and runs. He hits through the line, loves boundaries. So you could try and dry him up. He's either a block or four man. Work on his patience. He also has issues running between the wickets, so he doesn't like to just drop it and run. Extra cover, straighter, mid-off, mid-on, bowl full. Set the field for it.
I know no bowler is a robot and you can't just keep on doing the same thing over and over, but this is pretty much what Bresnan wants to be trying to do. Bringing the batsman onto the front foot, but not full enough for him to be driving comfortably through the offside. You can see how high up on the bat that ball hit. He's not going to be able to drive that comfortably, and there are two slips on the gully waiting. Any bit of movement off the seam, you have a chance.
35 for none. Not a cloud in the sky, the sun beating down on what is already a dry surface. Three wickets have fallen, last three batsmen for England. First ball of the day was a wicket. Bresnan nicking off to Ryan Harris, then some tail-end runs. Now the opening partnership has put on 35 for Australia. Still Anderson, it will be his sixth over. Round the wicket, stray onto the pads, on the angle, the left-hander will tuck you away.
Just wondering if they are thinking that perhaps Rogers might just flick one into the mid-wicket region where he has a man fielding while he's bowling that line. I think, though, that last delivery, he was trying to get it to slant into the right hand and then straighten. But the ball isn't really doing a lot, so it's not too easy doing that delivery from now. Not a cloud in the sky. Good day to be batting. Are we going to see Graham Swann at 5 minutes to one? Customer one over before lunch.
Definitely, if Rogers gets on strike, why not? Next over, Rogers is on strike. Bowling from the nursery end, why not? Solid from Rogers, 37 for none.
Pretty much the start that Australia would have been hoping for. It's a very good pitch here. Batsmen certainly should not be complaining. Ball comes onto the bat.
There we go. Michael Holding has his wish. A little over of off spin. Token over just before lunch. And both of them has called it the Andrew Strauss Jazzer Manual of Captaincy. One over of spin just before lunch. In outfield, I'm guessing he likes to go after spin. Whether he will do one over before lunch, Shane Watson, we shall see. Deep, long on, definitely. Deep mid-wickets hovering. Man on the sweep. England trying to get two overs in. They're trying to get Joe Root warmed up on the sweep. Two overs of off-spin. Just a slip and a short leg.
Yes, Swanee, yes, Swanee.
Just been given the nod from the skipper. Get loose. If we get another over in, have a bowl. Yep. It will go down to Joe Root. Some rough just outside Rogers's off stump. One of the Australian bowlers might have been Siddle, just been running on. Same at Trent Bridge, getting into the danger area. so slow, if you drop short, can be worked away comfortably. That second innings, he was a little bit short at Trent Bridge. Boris is in the house. Tories everywhere.
Down.
Another two, this time on the offside. England keen to get one more over of Root at the pavilion end. Rogers just taking his time. Very slow off the back foot, Rogers, all eyes on the umpires. Plenty of deliveries in the red zone there for Swan, but at the moment it didn't spin big. We will get another over in. Root or Anderson, which way are they going? Change of plan, actually. Complete change of plan. Mr. Cook has had a rethink. Just a gut feeling. Root was told to warm up, and now I'm going to go for the big lad. Brezzy lad is on from the pavilion end. Two men out on the leg side. Watson very good on the pull. Anything back of a length, he rocks back off that front foot and pulls away to the leg. Two men are very square on the leg side. I'm sure Cook will want to move round a little bit. No fine leg.
Good start by Bresnan, though. That's the sort of delivery you see Watson missing and getting hit plumb in front. I think what Shane Watson may try and do, though, is shuffle a bit across to that off stump so that he can get that left leg outside the line of off stump. The slope will help Bresnan to bring the ball into him as a right-hander.
Close, very close. Yes, given. Very good from Alistair Cook. He's gone across with that front pad again. He's having a word with Rogers. He's going to review it.
That is the delivery, though, Nas. How many times have we seen him play across that front leg? Did he get the right leg? The left leg, rather, outside the line of off stump. That is what he needed to try and do. No problems with no ball. Did that left leg get outside the line of off stump? It doesn't look that way. It doesn't look that way.
No inside edge. He wasn't worried about the inside edge, Shane Watson. Look at that leg going across again. And remember, it's just got to be missing the stumps completely to be overruled. I'm not sure that's missing the stumps. Oh, that's hit in line, and that's hitting leg stump. A waste of a review. Very good from Bresnan, very good from Cook. Change of plan has worked. And England go to lunch with a very, very important wicket. Watson has got in, got out. He's gone LBW again for 30, 42 for one. Excellent from Bresnan. Got his length right, but Shane Watson yet again going across with that front pad. And that's just lifted the mood of all those England players. Lunch will taste that little bit better now.
Yeah, Watson was trying desperately to get that left leg outside the line of off stump. And the foot itself was outside the line of off stump, but not where the ball hit his leg. England team just heading to their dressing room. As Nasser said, they'll be a lot easier going into that dressing room with a wicket down.
It was going well for Australia up until the stroke of lunch. Last ball before lunch, Shane Watson, LBW, Bresnan, 30.
Four bowlers used by England. They were desperate to get that early wicket. It didn't come as early as they would have liked, but not too bad getting your first wicket in the 13th over.
So the game's moving forward again. England 361 all out thanks to some late runs from Broad and Swan today, and a brilliant 100 from Ian Bell. Australia 42 for one. Australia are 319 runs behind.
Well, there's never a good time to lose a wicket. It's a very good time to take a wicket. What about, just talk with David Neame, what about the review there?
It's a poor review, and I think you could say, you could tell that he was saying to the non-striking batsman, did I get outside? He's on middle. It's a poor review. They lose a review. They said, Michael Clarke, that we're not good on reviews. That's a shocker.
Well, they've not been thinking about it very hard, have they?
It's just out.
And we've seen, we know the way he plays. He must know the way he plays. He was perilously close earlier. There was one very close call earlier where it would have been an umpire's call. He's always going to have that front foot very much in front of the stumps, isn't he?
Well, he gets it planted, and that's his problem. Or it looks great when you're driving it down through mid-on, but look where this is going. You know, that's a ball that's going to hit middle, middle and leg, and he's hitting what? Middle and off at best on line. So it's a bad review and good decision. And from England's point of view, what a massive boost just before lunch. Go in now. A much happier team.
Yeah, I just think, you're looking at Chris Rogers there, he was quite wide on the crease as the non-striker. So he's got an angle which is, you know, it's not a very good angle to be looking at.
Well, it's human nature. You get two reviews, you've got to use them so carefully. And we'd all say throughout our careers, you're never out LBW, you're never out. But there's two of them out there. Was I outside the line? You're joking. They've lost one there. It's needless.
All right, well, good time for England, as we said. Good time for them to be taking a wicket, and they can think about how to take the next one through the lunch break. Right, coming up through this lunch break, we're going to have some more thoughts from Ian on tail-enders and how to get them out and why people aren't getting them out quite so easy as they used to. And we've got a club life, which takes us up to Scotland.
We have many rivals locally, but there's been something kind of toothy about playing against Fergusley for quite a while now.
Cricket's a smashing sport after the game, but where you meet in the bar. Some of their guys never came to the bar, you know, and they were looked on. We looked on them as snobs.
Of course, the lads didn't always agree with me, but I wasn't trying to be popular. I was trying to win.
gone. Wow. Edged again, this time gone. Five for Harris.
Beautiful from Swan, and the boundary's flowing.
Really important runs these for England.
Watson can hurt you. No need to run for that.
The Australian openers just have to keep saying to himself, get to lunch, don't lose a wicket.
Oh, close, very close. Yes, given.
Time gone. Five for Harris.
Beautiful from Swan, and the boundary's flowing.
Really important runs these for England.
Watson can hurt you. No need to run for that.
The Australian openers just have to keep saying to himself, get to lunch, don't lose a wicket.
Oh, close, very close. Yes, given.
Didn't quite make it then. One wicket down, Australia at lunch on day two. The difference between the two teams now 319. England bowled out this morning for 361. Actually, just a quick word then about that England total first of all with our expert pundits here. 361, how near to par, how below, what do you think about that one?
Okay. I think it's a 450 pitch when you look at it and batting conditions. 361 from 28 for 3 is pretty good.
Yeah, it's good recovery from that.
It's very good. Yeah, and I think England will take that all day long. Mm. And it gives them a little bit of leeway. I'm with Bumble, it's an OK score.
Yeah, so, I mean, obviously, everything depends on what happens over the next 24 hours or so.
Well, next couple of hours. See if England can tighten the screw or whether Australia can score the runs. I mean, the wicket down, it's a big, big lift to that England dressing room as you go in up there now. And they'll be all in there saying, OK, it's taken us 13 overs or whatever, it's 12 and a half overs. Come on, boys, get stuck in. Yeah. And hopefully, Bumble and I were talking about in the break there, hopefully England will start thinking about their field placings to Watson.
Yeah, he gets 30 again and he's a big lunger on the front foot, but they bring Khawaja in now. This is the new lad, Khawaja, batting at Lords, England, and fancy this.
Yeah, OK, let's come back to Watson in a moment. Let's just stick with England for a second. The recurrent theme throughout this series so far has been last-wicket partnerships. Obviously, at Trent Bridge, you know, two fabulous ones for Australia. This morning's one, 48 for the 10th wicket for England, was mighty handy.
It is, and I find it quite strange when I watch it. Why bowlers change their tactics. England were guilty of it at Trent Bridge and got carted around the ground. And Australia were guilty of it today. They went for the bang-in theory and got pulled and hooked out of the ground. And then, look at that, just kept on going.
Here's some of the hooks. I mean, a bit of an awkward one from Graham Swan. That tends to encourage bowlers, let's face it.
Well, if you look at this, here, look, this is what the point I'm trying to make. 49%, that's almost... half the deliveries are banged in short at that partnership, but that was Broad and Swan. And I don't understand it. There was a few good length, which got hammered, but 50%, 49% banged in. And where have we been getting the wickets? Let's have a look at the wickets in this series. The top six batsmen this series, there's three short. The rest are all on surprisingly good and full length. 48% full. And I think that's a reflection of the surfaces that you're playing on.
Yeah.
A little bit of reverse swing. But why do you change the tactics when you're bowling to 10 and 11?
Well, think back to your days. What did you do?
Well, you'd certainly, early, straight away, you'd bang in a couple straight away. But that's just to get them back. Mm. And then you try and bowl them out. Mm. But tail-enders don't like it very much, just be honest. And if you get it right and you can bang it in, and as soon as they come out, no friendly little half volley to get them going, bang it straight in, go for them, one or two deliveries, and then knock them over. And they're not so keen to come forward then.
Although, is there not a theory that tail-enders... Because everyone is encouraged to bat nowadays, so there are fewer genuine tail-enders nowadays. And let's also face it, the two there at number in that 10th wicket partnership are not normally in a 10th wicket partnership.
But most of those wickets are the top order, top six batsmen, who are your serious batsmen,